am Lance.
And I'm Dwayne, and welcome to another episode of TKS, A True Knowledge of Self, where we get to know ourselves from a biblical perspective. In our last episode, we were studying the Word of God, and we were looking at the very pillars of what constitutes the Christian lifestyle. And this was important because we're talking a lot about hip-hop culture, which also has pillars. And we looked at some of those pillars, and we'll be building on them even more in up-and-coming episodes. And we were trying to see, do they blend together, or is there a contrast? And thus far, we are seeing there's a tremendous contrast between the two. Yet, so many Christians are also engrossed in hip-hop culture. And it's for these reasons that God has allowed us to put forth these episodes where we can really study, take a fair look at it, and let the Word of God get the final say. Thus far, we looked at four powerful pillars as it relates to the Christian faith. And we were looking at it from the book of 2 Peter chapter 1, and we started right there from verse 4 and onward. And we saw that there were four very important foundational pillars to the Christian faith, one beginning with faith. The second was virtue. The third was knowledge, and then the fourth was temperance. And these are experiences that the Lord wants to bring us in. And the beautiful part of all of this is that He holds Himself responsible to help us develop these things. This is one of the comforts of Christianity. It is not something that we have to conjure up ourselves or accomplish by ourselves. Christ is our aid. He is our help. His Spirit is there to empower us, to lead us, to teach us, to guide us, and instruct us so that we don't fail. And ultimately, God's Word can be fulfilled now unto Him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy. We are very grateful for these precious promises. And now what we're going to do is we're going to build on the remaining pillars that we have not reviewed thus far. So, Lance, I'm excited.
Yeah.
It looks like God is speaking to your heart and mind as He's speaking to the several viewers that are watching. And I believe that the Lord is really helping us to get settled into His truth, both intellectually and spiritually, so that by His grace we cannot be moved.
That's right.
So now we're looking at some of these pillars here, and we looked at the first four, but there's more to even continue. So
right.
You take us over, man, and help us to see what are the remaining pillars and how can we bring this into our daily experience.
So the next step in the ladder is patience.
Mm-hmm.
That is something that we don't really think about as being supernatural, but many of us, have gone through experiences where that require a supernatural, otherworldly patience to get through and to deal with. So we're going to, again, go through some Bible verses because we're trying to figure out what does the Bible say? How does the Bible define these principles that it's laying out? So we're going to start in Revelation chapter 14, or Revelation 12, that for that matter. So we're looking at Revelation 12 and see how the Bible deals with this subject of patience.
Mm-hmm.
Revelation 12 and verse 17. Now, Revelation 12 is really dealing with this. I know in previous episodes we talked about the great controversy, the war that started in heaven and the fall of Lucifer from heaven to this earth, becoming Satan, the accuser of the brethren, the devil, the adversary. And we saw that he eventually took that war to the earth against God, but through his created beings.
Mm-hmm.
And so Revelation 12 is dealing with that context. And in verse 17 of Revelation chapter 12, it says thus. It says, and the dragon, which is Satan, according to verse 9, and the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Now, we're talking about patience, so what does that have to do with patience?
Mm-hmm.
Well, if we go forward a couple of chapters and look at Revelation chapter 14, in Revelation chapter 14, it says here in verse 12, it says, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. So we see that the patience of the saints is communicated as those that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony or the faith of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And now, when we talk about Peter's ladder here, and we talk about the faith and the virtue and the knowledge and the temperance and now the patience, we realize that patience is one of the identifying marks of God's people, essentially.
That's
so,
right.
So, there's more verses we're going to look at, but it's interesting that the Bible goes out of its way to note and repeat the characteristics of those that are standing ultimately in the last days and kind of standing against the warfare of Satan against God's remnant or his last remaining people on the earth before he comes. So look at Revelation chapter 2, and mm-hmm. we're going to turn to Revelation 2 and seek to understand this further. It says in Revelation 2 and verse 10, it says, "Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give you a crown of life." Hmm. Now, this idea, remember the faith of Jesus. Well, what was Jesus? Jesus was faithful unto death, even the death of the cross, as the Bible says. So he endured great affliction and trial. Essentially, he was the object of Satan's wrath. Mm-hmm. The wrath that we read there means his anger, his intense, murderous rage, mm-hmm. right? So Jesus was the object of that rage while he was walking the earth. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, Satan tried to kill him, literally.
Yeah.
And he thought that, you know, the suffering that he would put on them and the cross experience was Satan somehow getting a victory, getting an upper hand, winning a battle, if you will. We know that Jesus rose from the dead on the third day, and that was the victory. Mm-hmm. That completely solidified, if you will, that process of Jesus dying on the cross and raising from death unto life was the kind of the nail in the coffin, if you will, mm-hmm. for Satan's whole agenda. But when Jesus ascended, Satan eventually turned to inflict his wrath, and that new object became God's people. Mm-hmm. Okay, and God's people now, just like Christ, as Christ said, for example, in John 15, says, "If the world hates me, it's going to hate you as well."
That's right.
You know, you'll be hated by all nations for my name's sake. Mm-hmm. So now God's people become the object of Satan's wrath, and they now find themselves enduring the same trials and afflictions of Christ and the tribulation that Jesus went through. And now he's saying to his people, "As I did, be thou faithful unto death, and thou shalt have and receive a crown of life." And essentially, this is what it's talking about. Here is the patience mm-hmm. of the saints. Patience is really endurance.
Right.
The ability to supernaturally to endure trial, persecution, oppression that is coming from Satan, from a supernatural force. A greater supernatural force is willing to protect you and willing to save you and deliver you, even though you might have to go through this present danger and present suffering.
I see so many parallels. I mean, I can see a lot of lessons even that comes from this. Again, patience. Another term for patience, if we were to actually define the word patience, yeah. it's also long suffering.
Yes.
You know, being able to suffer long, mm-hmm. to endure, right? And when you look at this speaks volumes to our society today. What are some of the reasons why God encourages us to be patient? One of the first reasons why is because he says, well, first of all, vengeance is mine.
Yep.
The Lord says, I'll take care of everything. So God is saying, you can be patient because you don't have to lose your patience and take control of the circumstance mm-hmm. because I'm going to be able to take care of it myself. I am going to take vengeance. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. The guilty will suffer sooner or later. Mm-hmm. So one of the things that can enable us to be patient is that very fact that we can trust God is going to do this. God is going to handle these things in life that happens that causes me sometimes to lose my patience.
Yeah.
If ever there was a time for a message like that, it's right now. Because there is a lot of, as you stated, social unrest. There is a lot of things happening right now that does not look fair. There are judicial systems that are being put in question. There are police officers that are being put in question. There are civilians that are being put in question. And it seems like everybody is in a state of unrest, and we're losing patience and trying to handle situations ourselves.
Yeah.
And we're not necessarily saying, God, what have you told us to do on how to respond to the crisis we're in right now? And one of them is to be patient, mm-hmm. to be long-suffering. Mm-hmm. In the midst of crisis and trial, do not lose your Christianity. Yeah. Maintain your Christ-likeness in the midst of whatever trial or tribulation you're going through.
So oppression and persecution and injustice is not an excuse to abandon morality.
Correct. Mm-hmm. And this is a message that is needed right now, mm-hmm. today. because individuals are losing their patience. And I understand the frustration of the patients because it's never a good thing to see injustice take place. Yep. On either side, yep. We have police officers right now that are looking at themselves as victims. We have civilians right now that are looking at themselves as victims. And both of them are in such a perplexed situation, they're responding to it. But the responses many a times is not the counsel that God is giving from His words. Yep. And as a result of that, we are allowing the flesh to lead us. And we have to be careful. Funny enough, and we're going to talk about this in another episode, we see that even in the midst of this social unrest right now, there are hip-hop icons and individuals that are kind of putting themselves in the forefront to try to be the leaders and to lead people and to guide them. Yep. But we're understanding there's a deeper picture going on in the backdrop. And when we start talking about Bible prophecy, this thing is going to come together really powerfully.
That's right.
So I'm grateful for the way that we're studying something as simple as patience and being able to see how necessary it is. Mm-hmm. And it must be applied in our lives even unto death.
Yes.
As Christ did when he walked on this earth.
That's right.
Very, very important point. I appreciate
it. So let's go on, and I want to look at Matthew 10 and 22. We're still talking about patience, an essential step in this Peter's ladder that we've been talking about. Mm-hmm. Matthew 10 and verse 22 says the following. And we said this, but I'll read it here. It says, "And ye shall be hated of all men for my name's sake, but he that endureth to the end shall be saved."
That's
the principle,
right.
Again, reiterated.
Yep.
Endurance, patience, long-suffering, as you said. Mm-hmm. Hebrews 6 and verse 12. Hebrews 6 and verse 12. We'll turn there and read it. Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 12. It says, "That ye be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises." Mm-hmm. So there, remember, we talked about faith there previously in Hebrews 11, and the idea that faith translates into action. And that essentially is how men are able to access the grace of God and the salvation of God. But it says here now that the faith and patience was what allowed individuals in the past mm-hmm. to inherit the promises of God. So God is putting forth these promises. Again, we have to choose whether or not we're going to subscribe and follow them.
That's
not
right.
Just intellectually, but at this level that is going to actually dictate and influence and command our actions and our behavior. And if we do this and exhibit these things, we, like others in the past, other faithful individuals in the past, we will inherit the promises. Now let's look at James. James 1 and verse 12. It says, "Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life which the Lord hath promised to them that love him." So again, endurance, inheriting the promises. Now we know it's salvation, the crown of life, enduring to the end, the same shall be saved. And it says again that there's a blessing to the man that endureth temptation. Those that are able supernaturally to receive what God is offering and withstand the advances and the offensive force of Satan's wrath will be rewarded.
Mm-hmm.
God is going to repay.
Amen.
God is going to recompense. God is going to have vengeance. It's not our responsibility,
right,
to take it into our own hands and exact justice.
Mm-hmm.
It's not our responsibility. So we have to be willing to acknowledge that, accept that, and see that God's wisdom must have a solution. It must provide a solution through a different avenue, a different means by which we can obtain this.
Now, so that individuals who may be viewing do not see this position we're taking in an extreme fashion, we are not saying that we do not respond to social injustice things of that nature, that we should just simply sit back and let evil just ride and have its course simply because, you know, we are to exercise patience that God will take care of it.
Yep.
What we are saying is that God has given us a methodology of how to approach social injustice, but it was always in the context of the great controversy. It was always in the context of the war between Christ and Satan over the mind of man and dealing with the issue of sin versus righteousness. I stated before, and I think it's worthy to state again, an individual cannot legislate evil. You cannot put together enough laws to stop evil. Evil just constantly keeps coming up in new manifestations. Years and years and years ago, individuals would use sticks and stones. Today they use guns, and now they're using lasers and all sorts. I mean, it's just new manifestations of the same issue, which is violence, violence in the heart. So what Christ wants us to understand is that our battle is against sin. Our battle is against the issue of sin and dealing with that. And that's how Jesus worked. He didn't allow himself to get caught up into the political games and all these things like we see a lot of people doing today, but he dealt with the issue of sin in the human heart. And this is when an individual was truly delivered from all these evils. But if we just simply are, you know, doing other things, it may not meet the goal. And we constantly see that. So we're not negating the fact that we have to address social injustice. Yep. We're saying it needs to be addressed in the context of the great controversy. It's an issue of sin, and that's our fight. That is our issue. We must go territory after territory and make aggressive warfare against soul-destroying sins yep. that are taking place in our world today.
Yep. And so when we talk about the steps again, we got to go to the next step. And it's equally important. These steps are not one is better than the other or this or that. They're all equally valuable and equally important and equally essential.
That's right.
And it's not like he gives you one and he doesn't give you the other. Or he gives you one and you got to work towards the other. He's willing to give you all.
Right.
If you receive by faith, right? So we talked about faith and virtue and knowledge and temperance and patience. And now we're going to talk about the next step, which is godliness. Mm-hmm. And so I'm going to look at Leviticus 19. We're going back to an important place in the Old Testament, and Leviticus 19 and the second verse. Leviticus 19 and the second verse. And it says the following. Leviticus 19 and verse 2.
All right.
It says, "Speak unto all the congregation of the children of Israel and say unto them, ye shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy." Mm-hmm. Now, that's a revolutionary concept. Mm-hmm. This is something in the theological world that we call corporate solidarity. Mm-hmm. The idea that like is like. So if God is holy, then his people are to be holy. And that's just the way it is, because mm-hmm. God is going to take care of his people. God is going to give something to his people. He's going to give them something that they cannot generate themselves. He's going to cover them with his garment and take away their filthy garment. Mm-hmm. They're going to become sons and daughters of God. And as his children, they're going to reflect their parent. All right. Mm-hmm. So God is holy. So his people must be holy. Mm-hmm. And this is reiterated. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter and chapter 1. And it kind of quotes from this same passage. Mm-hmm. And we'll look at it this way. 1 Peter 1 verse 15 and 16. It says, "But as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation. Because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy." Mm-hmm. So when we talk about godliness, we're talking about holiness, mm-hmm. right? And we're talking about holiness, we're talking about God and his people being both holy. In other words, when God looks at us, he should see himself. Mm-hmm. And not because we've done anything good, not because we deserve it, mm-hmm. but because if we access the grace that God is offering and he forgives us of our sins and cleanses us from all unrighteousness, essentially makes us righteous. If he does that, then when he looks at us, he sees himself mm-hmm. because he clothed us, he filled us, he baptized us, he did all these things and he changed us, transformed us. So he looks at us and it's like he's looking in a mirror.
Yep.
And that's what really God is looking for. He's not looking for us. He's looking for himself in us.
That's right.
And when he sees that, he says, "Here are my children. I am holy. My children are holy." And he's the one that makes all of it happen.
That's right.
So it says that in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 30, mm-hmm. it says, "But of him are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption." So Jesus Christ now, the Son of God, is the embodiment of all of these attributes and all of these virtues. And he is the one that is to us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. So the godliness that we need, the godliness that God says we are to be, the holiness that we are to be, that we are to have, is only accessible and only embodied and only realized in Jesus Christ. And as we accept Him and accept His merits, then we can be that which God said and originally actually designed us to be.
And this is important because when we think about why hasn't Jesus come back yet, you know, when you think about how many people you may have seen in your youth that have said, the Lord is coming, the world is coming to an end, etc. And I remember seeing that when I was 4 years old. I'm 42 years old now, and I still have not seen the Lord come yet. So someone could fall into a state of disbelief as a result of this. But we don't understand what God is trying to do. What God is trying to do is produce a character within us that is just like His. This is how the world got started with man, and this is how the world must end when it comes to those whom He's going to bring home with Him.
That's right.
It was because of Lucifer becoming unlike Him that he earned the name Satan, which means adversary. He earned the name devil, which means slanderer. And God does not want to bring another adversary, enemy, or slanderer into His house. So the reason why the Lord has not come back yet is because He still doesn't see the character reflected. He is waiting with longing desire to see the character of Christ perfectly reproduced in His people. And when this happens, He will come. So godliness is very much high upon the ladder, but nevertheless it's there. And we can obtain it through Christ and His power enabling us, as we talked about, to accomplish anything that He has called us to do.
That's right. So 8 steps, we're moving on to the next one. So far we have faith, virtue, knowledge.
Temperance.
Patience. Godliness, and now brotherly kindness. So this is something that humanity struggles with.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why, in my estimation, why it's so high on the ladder, if you will.
That's right.
It's because it can only be done by possessing those things that precede it. So let's look at John 15. Brotherly kindness. I mean, it is as simple as the phrase communicates. John 15, and we're reading 13 to 15. It says, "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you." So how is brotherly kindness, in its truest sense, in its essence, how is that exhibited?
Mm-hmm.
Laying down your life for your friends.
Mm-hmm.
That's a tall order.
It is.
And look at John 13. John 13, 34 and 35. John 13, 34 and 35 says this. "A new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another." Hmm. Brotherly kindness. This is actually now, from the words of Jesus Himself, is the way that people will know, mm-hmm, if you are one of my disciples. This is how men will know if you are one of my sons or daughters. So this idea of Peter's ladder, these pillars, if you will, we're, mm-hmm, talking about the faith and the virtue and the knowledge and the patience and the temperance and the patience and the godliness and the brotherly kindness. It leads us naturally into the eighth, leg of the ladder.
Mm-hmm.
And it is charity, right?
Yes, sir.
It says charity, which means love, right?
Mm-hmm.
Charity means love. Love is so vitally central and important, essentially the central pillar of God's government, that we're gonna have to dedicate an entire episode to this subject. Love happens to be also one of those pillars that hip hop articulates and highlights in that peace, love, unity, safely having fun. And I believe that the love that the Bible is going to talk about and the love that hip hop is talking about are going to be completely opposite things.
Yeah, this is one of the most abused terms.
Right.
In the human language today,
that's right,
is the word love. I mean, we could say we love somebody and then our follow-through can absolutely contradict what we just said.
Yep.
And that's where we are today. And that's the reason why love does need to be qualified. Mm-hmm. You know, we're talking about pillars because we need to set a foundation, because again, with all thy getting, get understanding. We want to know, how do we walk in the experience of these things? But at the same time, there is a power out there that is seeking to contrast what God has stated. And one of the terms they're using is the very thing that is foundational to God and his government, which is love.
Yep.
So there needs to be an exposure. There needs to be a clear line divided showing what is love from the biblical context, and then how does that compare to the love that is being purported throughout hip hop culture? And we have to see those lines clearly, and then we have to make a choice.
That's right. And I have to, you know, give a little foreshadowing, a little teaser. One is very deep and one is very shallow.
That is correct.
I mean, one is extremely deep and limitless.
That's right.
And one is very surface and superficial and shallow.
Yeah.
And once we start peeling things back and understand that really we don't want superficial. We don't want something that's only going to go so far, because we need something greater. We need something that's going to solve life's problems. We need something that's going to correct situations. And what we're not saying is we're trying to fix all worldly systems. That's not what we're talking about. Mm-mm. We're talking about a situation that is so critical that God is going to have to step in himself and literally recreate the whole thing in order for it to be set up properly.
That's right.
We're not looking to change this system. We're looking for this system to eventually expire and be replaced by God's system. Mm-hmm. And only those who endure to the end will be saved.
That's right.
So, you know, this is, when we talk about these principles, we want to promote and we want to kind of instill principles that are going to lead to true knowledge of self.
Amen. Amen. Well, once again, we have been very blessed in our studies, and we have gotten through seven of those very precious pillars that really constitutes what it is to be a Christian and to live a life according to the principles of Christ. And I believe that as we day by day put into practice what we have learned, there's a beautiful term that I'd like to share with you all that is a term called experimental religion. And what that simply means is taking the words of God as you see them, and then once you understand them, seek to apply it. Seek to apply it in your life. How can I apply faith or virtue or, you know, temperance and knowledge and all of these other wonderful things? And you will see that it is through experimental religion that it becomes real to you, because a gospel that is not practical, quite honestly, is a worthless gospel. And this is what we need to look at when we think about the true gospel, and we also think about the gospel of hip hop. We have to make that comparison and let the word of God be true and let every other man be a liar. And therefore, I want to encourage you to keep studying to show yourselves approved unto God. Share with a friend what you've been learning. Go ahead and dig deeper and deeper. And my hope and prayer is that the next time we come, that you will join us. And until then, remember the blessed words of Proverbs chapter 2 and verse 6, which tells us, "It is the Lord that giveth wisdom, and out of his mouth comes knowledge and understanding." God bless.